Hello there, good afternoon and a warm welcome to the very last edition of Nationwide for the year 2016. I'm Joseph Johnson, glad to have your company. Now, less than 48 hours into the year 2017, people are still embarking on journeys out of the Federal Capital Territory. Olajide Bello, who visited the Nnamdi Azikiwe International Airport, reports.
At the Nnamdi Azikiwe International Airport, passengers were still seen tripping in their numbers at both the international and domestic wings of the airport. Responses from the passengers, however, seemed unpleasant as they shared their experiences at the airport.
So already I'm being delayed for another 1 hour, 1 hour 30 minutes for it to land, and then they call for boarding. It's pathetic, it's chaotic. Well, they are using weather, we agree that weather, but I don't think it's the weather. But
they're going to pick passengers from Abuja to Lagos with the same plane, bring those passengers from Lagos back to Abuja with the same plane, and then we have been here from morning waiting for a shuttle to Lagos back to now take us to Port Harcourt. In a country where you have an aviation minister, where you have a working system, this should not happen.
Them along, you don't tell them the reason why you're not flying. You're telling me operational reason. I'm not your staff. How am I meant to know what is operational, what is that? Do you understand? And what's the whole essence of buying your ticket in good time? Because you know that at the end of the year, there's usually a rush. So you go ahead and purchase your ticket on time, only for you to get here. And they are not even giving you any tangible reasons.
They also bear their minds on measures to be put in place by the federal government to put airline operators on their toes.
I think that, you know, there should be sanctions for these kinds of things, especially on the...
I think the Minister for Aviation should look into this and see how to correct it.
Meanwhile, efforts to speak to regulatory authorities proved futile as they were not on ground to respond to our inquiries. In Abuja, Olajide Bello, NTA News.
And as the new year draws closer, the level of patronage is high at the Idu Railway Station, recorded high influx of passengers. Chindima Anson Agomo reports that as at 6 a.m., passengers were already seated, waiting to be attended to.
With less than 48 hours to New Year, Idu Railway Station is witnessing increase in patronage by passengers traveling to Kaduna. Ticketing started about 6 a.m., for the first train, AK1, that usually departs at 7 a.m. prompt.
The service is good. It is punctual. I've been on it about 10, 12 times, and it has always left on time and arrived on time.
Why the second train is expected to depart by 2:20 p.m. Some passengers speak on their impression about the servicing of the railway station.
Good service. This should continue in this country.
The service here is okay, but I think Europe needs some adjustment.
It doesn't have the cabs, as in at the junction there. They will convey us to the station.
Lifts, I can say. It's very small. It takes only, I think, 4 or 5 people. And here, people come in with the heavy load. The staircase is very long. So, more especially women, they are coming with children and heavy loads.
Meanwhile, the transport fee from Abuja to Kaduna still remains the same, 600 naira per head.
The Nigerian Railway Corporation and the federal government are doing everything possible to make this travel befitting and pleasurable for all our passengers.
Abuja Kaduna train. Yeah, that's the first trip, AK1. A is for Abuja, K is for Kaduna. The first trip is one. That's why we call it AK1. Three trip.
This is exactly 7 a.m. and the train is leaving exactly 7 a.m. Most of the passengers we spoke to expressed satisfaction over the services of the people in Abuja, Chidima and Sinagomo and TNE.
The Bagana-Guta Bridge linking River Benue is expected to provide an alternative route to Lokoja-Abuja Highway, in addition to reducing travel distance between the north and south. Now, about 10 years after it was abandoned, arrangements are being concluded to actualize the project under a public-private partnership initiative. Onoto Yakub has an update on the bridge.
The former president, Olusegun Obasanjo, in 2007, inaugurated the construction of the Bagana-Guto Bridge across the River Benue, the 1.3-kilometer dual carriage bridge to connect a 90-kilometer road. Is a public-private partnership project with the involvement of the federal government as well as Nasarawa and Kogi states. It was conceived as an alternative route to the Abuja-Lokoja Highway to link the southeast through the federal capital territory, Abuja, to the northern part of Nigeria. However, with almost 10 years gone and nearly 6 years after the date set for its completion, the project is yet to see the light of the day. The visit by officials of the new engineering procurement and construction firm, who have now repackaged the project, is to assess the durability of the old pillars with a view to actualizing the project.
At the moment, we know that we will commence this business as soon as possible. You can see the number of Chinese that accompanied us. They've gone very far with us. Who signed MOU, who signed all the necessary documents.
We will do some text for the older bridge, and then we will a new plan for the whole bridge to rebuild it.
We, the people of Guto, will be very happy because all of our economic will be having place of carrying it out and bring other things inside our community.
We beg God to see, to start them. From the beginning to our finish.
The project is expected to be completed within 2 years. From Bagana, Onotu Yakub, NTA News.
Let's turn our attention to health now, because over 500 participants joined major partners in the public and private sectors in 2016 in Montreal, Canada, to mobilize 13 billion naira at the fifth Global Fund Replenishment Conference to fight AIDS, tuberculosis and malaria. In this special report, Joy Osiago takes a look at the Global Fund initiative and the benefits to developing economies like Nigeria.
The Global Fund initiative has fought passionately to eliminate three major diseases for over 14 years. As observed by a member of the delegation from the Federal Ministry of Health, Nigeria has benefited from the contributions over the years.
Global Fund came into place around 2002 when we are struggling to scale up HIV treatment. Then we barely had 25 sites providing ART in the program. With the support of PEPFAR and Global Fund, we are able to scale up rapidly, and today we have over 800,000 persons on treatment for antiretroviral in the country.
With the latest global goal to eradicate AIDS, tuberculosis and malaria by the year 2030, the replenishment of the fund cannot be taken for granted. Montreal, Quebec, Canada played host to a mammoth crowd from different parts of the globe as they gathered for the fifth Fund Replenishment Conference. Canadian Prime Minister Justin Trudeau called on all parties to pledge with compassion. And indeed, many nations answered the passionate plea as $13 billion was mobilized for the 2017 to 2019 period to support major programs designed towards the attainment of the major goal.
The citizens of our global community can look proudly at what has been accomplished today. Thanks to an inspirational demonstration of unshakable will and collaboration, we will rid the world of AIDS, TB, and malaria.
The conference also offered concerned parties opportunities to analyze major challenges with accessibility, stigmatization, and human rights issues.
These diseases are prevalent in Africa, in our rural communities most. So advocacy should go down to the rural areas.
It's important to dialogue with men, bring them to the table so that they understand where the woman's perspective is coming from as well.
Because everyone says it matters, resource mobilization efforts are still in progress. For as some stakeholders say, given a model that works, partners may as well raise the needed funds to end the epidemics by the year 2030.
In Montreal, Quebec, Canada, Joy Osiago,
NTA News.
Thank you, Joy. Canada mobilized $13 billion at the conference and not 13 billion naira, as earlier mentioned. And now let's go over to our Lagos Network Center with Vera standing by to give us the latest from that zone. Vera, compliments of the season.
Compliments of the season. Good evening and welcome to Lagos. In furtherance of his commitment to ensuring safety on highways across the country during this festive period, officials of the Federal Road Safety Corps were at the Lagos Ibadan Expressway to ensure safety and responsible driving by motorists. Rotimi Oluwagbemi reported officials of the Federal Ministry of Power, Works and Housing were also on ground to monitor effectiveness of the traffic management system in place for the festive period.
Lagos Ibadan Expressway, which is without doubt the busiest exit from Lagos, experienced a lot of gridlock and fatal accidents week before the U-tide. This prompted relevant agencies to put measures in place to tackle these challenges. This patrol by the Federal Road Safety Corps is to ensure free and safe driving on the Lagos Expressway during the festive period. The team was led by Lagos and Ogun State sector commanders.
We made a promise this year that instead of any motorists sleeping on the road, we FRSC personnel will be the one to sleep on the road. And you could see that we have kept to our promise.
Corridors have given us a challenge is the Sagam interchange up to J3. We actually envisage this because I will know that the number of deaths will have risen more than this because of the construction of the road.
If you are a passenger, be active. You have every right to stop that driver before he kills you. And you should realize that only the living celebrate. You cannot celebrate if you are not alive.
Officials of the Federal Ministry of Power, Works and Housing were also on ground to ensure that traffic management system put in place to ensure smooth driving is effective.
Honorable Minister's insistence saying that we should go to the road and find out how the public, the motoring public, whether they are impressed or not, so that we can know the areas we have to improve upon.
The suffering of the people has been alleviated. The comfort on the road too has also been improved and traveling time has also been reduced.
Road safety officials also sensitized motorists on the need to maintain speed limit, obey traffic rules and avoid accidents on the expressway. In Lagos, Otimi Oluwagbemi, NTA News.
In a concerted effort to reduce travel time on the Lagos-Ekpe Expressway, Lagos State Government has cleared all bottlenecks at roundabout along Ekate-Elegushi axis of the state. This is also geared towards boosting business activities around the area and in keeping with the mega-city vision of the state. Nusa Usula tells us more.
Acting Commissioner for Transportation, Anofi Elegushi, who briefed the newsmen after the opening of the modified Jakonde Junction, said Governor Akinwumi Ambode's administration was determined more than ever to make this period stress-free as far as traffic was concerned.
Simultaneously, we are working on the 4th, the 5th and the 8th runabout. And in the next year budget, we have provision for other runabouts too, because it's the way to go. We can't go on with runabouts. It's giving us a lot of problem.
The project supervisor, Biodun Otunola, added that the 3rd, 4th and 8th roundabouts would also be reconstructed to ease traffic congestion in the area and would be fully completed by January.
Based on detailed study that we've done, the roundabouts are actually the major cause of the problem. So what we're doing here is what we call junction improvement.
Some commuters commended the Lagos State Government for the initiative as this will ease traffic congestion in the area.
I feel the traffic will be less.
If it's going to be better, it's good, but it's causing a lot of issues right now.
According to the state government, signalized system would be adopted instead of the manual alternation to ensure free flow of traffic and bring sanity back to the road. In Lagos, Nusa Usula, NTA News.
The Nigerian police will soon begin a general reconstruction of police barracks nationwide. Deputy Inspector General of Police in charge of works, Maigari Diko, disclosed this during his visit to the site of the collapsed building at the police college, Ikeja. Abiola Oni has more.
The Deputy Inspector General of Police in charge of works, Maigari Diko, said the force is making plans to reconstruct buildings in the police barracks across the nation to avoid a repeat of the unfortunate incidents. He sympathized with families of officers that lost their lives in the block that collapsed in the early hours of Christmas.
For me, the force is not sitting idle. We are doing everything to come up with a very robust renovation plan for all the barracks nationwide. And already the Inspector General of Police has made submission to the federal government to that effect. And as soon as we get the fund ready, we will commence work.
The DIG also advised occupants of three other dilapidated blocks in the barracks to evacuate these buildings as they pose a threat to human life.
We don't just throw them out. When we throw you out, we'll give you something to go and look for alternative accommodation. I will call it rent supplement or lodging allowance. So it's not that we just come and force you or the progress come and push you away. No, it's not like that. We're pushing it with small allowance that will make them look for accommodation.
It will be recalled that the collapsed W block of the Nigeria Police Barracks Ikeja left two officers dead. In Lagos, Abiola Oni, NTA News.
You're still watching Nationwide News on the NTA Network Service. It's back to Joseph for more reports on Nationwide. Good evening.
Vera from our Lagos Network Center there. The Senate President Bukola Saraki has assured Nigerians of enhanced collaboration and cooperation between the executive and legislature in the new year towards addressing the nation's fundamental challenges for a better and prosperous Nigeria. Senator Saraki gave the assurance while speaking to journalists shortly after an audience with President Muhammadu Buhari. State House correspondent Adamu Sambo reports on this and President Buhari's assent to another bill passed by the National Assembly.
The Senate President Bukola Saraki, who is also the chairman of the National Assembly, met President Muhammadu Buhari behind closed doors for about 1 hour. He told newsmen later that his routine interaction with the Nigerian leader is about the future of Nigeria, on which they are both genuinely committed to improving.
We on part of the National Assembly are continue to give all our support to the executive, ensuring that the right things are done. Our attention will always be on the economy, because that's really the major issue for us as a country, to see some of the economic bills that we put before us, to see that we get them passed. We worked on the budget, to see that the budget process also in 2017 is a greater improvement to 2016, to see that government implements the budget early. And also, one of our pet projects is the issue of the Made in Nigeria, to see that government also can continue to support Nigerian industries in this area, so that we can begin to see a cushion of the difficult times that Nigerians are going through. So this next year is very, very important to us.
The Senate President described the fall of Sambisa Forest as fulfilling and reassuring that the Boko Haram insurgency is soon to become history.
It's a great feat, and it shows what we can do as a country when we have the commitment, the sincerity of purpose, and the leadership that is required to do that. As we've done that in Northeast, I believe the other challenges before us on the issue of fight against corruption, providing jobs, peace in the Niger Delta, I'm sure that we can do that again together.
Meanwhile, President Muhammadu Buhari has signed into law the Endangered Species Control of International Trade and Traffic Amendment Bill 2016.
The intent of this amendment is to bring the penalty provisions in line with economic realities and to act as a deterrent for people from trafficking and trading in endangered species, because endangered species are preserves of the country.
This brings the number of bills signed by President Muhammadu Buhari to 17 in the last 3 months.
And you're going to see more of that also in 2017. There are a lot of bills already in the pipeline. For us in the Senate, for example, in the last session, just this last 3 months, we did more than the entire year that we've done. So you can see that National Assembly is settling down, and as such, you'll be seeing more bills here for the president to sign.
The National Assembly resumes plenary on the 10th of January 2017. From the State House, Adamu Sambo, NTA News.
Director General of the Nigerian Television Authority says the organization is committed to combating corruption and bad governance in Africa through content and programs that will deepen democracy on the continent. The Director General stated these when he received Save Democracy Group Africa in Abuja. Aliu Tukru has details.
Save Democracy Group Africa is a non-governmental organization aimed at improving governance and promoting democracy in the continent. The visit to the NTA is to congratulate the Director General of the Authority for his style of leadership and to partner the NTA on the upcoming annual National Political Summit. The summit is a platform where political leaders will discuss challenges of democracy.
Because democracy is a process, it's not an event. So it's a human event, and there are always going to be problems as we go on. So what can we do to solve those problems so that we take maximum advantage of democracy?
Director General of the NTA says, since the continent is losing more through bad governance, there is need for greater transparency in governance and in doing business.
So we may be partially commercialized, but that fact does not blind us to our social responsibility. Where democracy thrives, we are all the beneficiaries. If it doesn't thrive, we will all pay the price.
The annual National Political Summit is slated for January 2017. Vice President Yemi Osinbajo expected to chair the occasion. In Abuja, Aliu Tukur, NTA News.
The federal government says it is working with the private sector to make major festivals in the country attractive to domestic and foreign tourists to key into global festivals. This was a message by the Minister of Information and Culture, Lai Mohammed, to the 2016 edition of the Ijakadi Festival in Ofa. Anthony Forson reports.
The minister, who was represented by the general manager, NTA Ilori, Raphael Arulogun, expressed satisfaction with the organization, hence his assurances that the federal government will include Ijakadi Festival in its capacity-building memorandum of understanding arrangement.
We at the Federal Ministry of Information and Culture will provide the enabling environment for the festival to achieve its full potential.
Kwara State Governor Abdul Fattah Ahmed was represented at the occasion by the State Commissioner for Environment.
This association is committed to providing incentives for investors in the tourism sector and maintaining a peace and secure environment that is essential for tourism to thrive.
We want to make a general appeal for all sons and daughters to appreciate this annual event, which is aimed at bringing everybody home for the purpose of socializing with each other.
Ijakadi has come to stay as an avenue for the Ofa people to showcase their rich culture. In Ofa, Anthony Forson, NTA News.
Over 100 communities benefit from health care projects in Zamfara State. Let's join Asmau in our Sokoto Network Center to give us details of these and other reports from that zone. Good to see you, Asmau.
Hello, Joseph. Good afternoon and welcome to Sokoto. The need for governments, educational institutions, and relevant stakeholders to rise against the challenges of the country's education and put the sector on the right footing has been stressed. This was what formed the central thrust of a paper presented at the third Founders Day lecture of the Sokoto State University. Usman Muhammad Binji reports that visitor to the university, Governor Amin Waziri Tambuwal, also restated government's commitment to make the university great. His report is here presented.
The third Founders Lecture was organized by the Sokoto State University to acknowledge founders and to review problems, challenges, and prospects ahead. Vice Chancellor Sokoto State University, Professor Nuhu Yakub, said they are working to ensure the lofty ideals behind the establishment of the university become reality. The guest lecturer, State Commissioner of Higher Education, Alasabi Isagada, identified inadequate funding and poor access to education as some of the problems facing education in Nigeria. He said for the state of emergency in education declared in Sokoto State to succeed, the university and other tertiary institutions should do more researches and partnering with stakeholders to propose solutions to problems of education.
Ensuring that all children have access to and complete free and compulsory primary education of good quality.
Governor Aminu Waziri Tambuwal said Government is working towards making the university one of the best in the country. The Sir College of Health Sciences will be created in the university in addition to numerous infrastructures to be provided.
We are talking to them to ensure that our students are registered and we shall pay because our government is a responsive government and very responsible government.
Former High Commissioner of Nigeria to South Africa, Ambassador Ashoka Malami, which shared the occasion, described education as a legacy which the university is keenly seeking to perpetuate. In Sokoto, Shoaib Mohammed Dati, NTA News.
About 150 communities in Zamfara State are to benefit from a health project tagged Hard to Reach for 3 years. These communities are from the grassroots, in which the beneficiaries are mostly women and children. Halil Muhammad Umar has the details.
Healthcare services are usually inaccessible by people living in remote areas, resulting to high mortality in rural settlements. Hard to Reach is a 3-year project focusing on maternal and newborn child health in places that are difficult to access. Areas being taken by the project include antenatal care, routine immunization, health education, and attending to delivery, among others. The third quarter review meeting, which drew various stakeholders, is among others aimed at assessing performances, achievements, and challenges of the project implementation, with a view to coming up with strategies for its improvements and sustainability. In their separate remarks, the Permanent Secretary, Ministry of Health, Dr. Umar Lawal Bungudu, and the Executive Secretary, Zamfara State Primary Health Care Board, Alhaji Yusuf Musa Mafara, described the project as remarkable, while promising to mobilize all available resources to ensure its sustainability.
We are proud to make some impact and also to say we appreciate the contribution of each and every one of you in heart-rich activities.
We do our best to see that our political leaders, you know, are committed to this issue.
In her remark, the national coordinator of the project, Mrs. Esther Obinya, noted that the commitment of the benefiting communities will go a long way in making the project successful.
We are trying to see how we can put in place a plan to sustain this thing.
From Gusau, Halil Muhammad Umar, NTA News.
And that's our package from Sokoto. Nationwide continues with Joseph in Abuja.
Thank you, Asmao. Just time to remind you that you can watch this news live online via the NTA mobile app, which you can download on your Android device at the Google Play Store or at the Apple Store if you use devices with iOS. Stay with us here on NTA Nationwide, because still to come, former political appointees in Ogun State end the year 2016 smiling as they receive their severance allowances from the state government. Details just after these messages.
From what we have seen, we have the capacity which we can rapidly develop or feed ourselves. If we don't import rice, we stop importing corn and other grains, Nigeria will have plenty of money to invest into developing industries, especially manufacturing, textiles and so on, and develop iron and steel, and complement the infrastructure development. So really, the opportunities are virtually limitless, and we are very, very aware of this, and we are prepared to explore it to the fullest.
Living mixtures and all sorts of herbs.
Bond you! Now she must die!
Caroline, she is not dead, just comatose.
She was chopped tomatoes?
This week on your award-winning comedy series, Professor John Bull, starring Kanayo Okanayo, Mercy Johnson, Queen Wokoye, Yomi Fash Lanso, Stephen Odingbe.
So you guys like all vegetables? These are leafy vegetables. Spinach, spirulina, barley grass, it's all the great stuff.
Please watch it, because the way you're going and you're drinking this thing, very soon I see person they talk, they know they see the person, not only voice and sound.
Professor John Bull this Tuesday and Friday, 8:30 to 9 p.m. on NTA Network International and Star Times.
Ow!
It's yummy.
Fundament.
Over and out.
Welcome to the new speed of life. Do you crave class? Do you have taste? And do you care about comfort? If you do, then for your next event, a stay away from home, a business trip, or a holiday, visit Jade's Hotel at 24 Undola Crescent, Wuse Zone 5, Abuja. Check out our world-class services, exquisite suites, restaurant and bar, gymnasium, spa, and grills, and our outdoor catering services and cuisines. At Jade's, it can only be better. For bookings and reservations, visit us today at 24 Undola Crescent, Wuse Zone 5, Abuja. Or visit www.jadeshotels.com. Our email address is info@jadeshotels.com. You can also call us at 09291-9321 or 0810-909-7956. Jade's Hotels. Welcome to life.
The essence of having a leader. When you promise, you make sure that you fulfill your promises. And that's what I'm after in particular, the success of my husband's administration. And I can't do it alone except with the help of the governor's wives, and all members of our Progressive Party.
It's that time of the year when we appreciate all those that meant so much to us. Our sponsors, our clients, government at all levels, corporate bodies, advertisers, religious bodies, civil society groups, political parties, business, and above all, you, our esteemed viewer. Together, we made 2016 great. Together, we shall make 2017 even greater. That's why we say thank you. Merry Christmas and prosperous New Year.
NTA Properties Investment Company Limited, a subsidiary of the Nigerian Television Authority, specializes in creating comfort in all areas of life, such as real estate investments, that is, land, houses, and office spaces, mass leasing, savings and loan scheme, household items and car loans, and so much more. Other information and entertainment services include Property and Style, a TV program that airs on the network service of the NTA, and also Property Connect, a nationwide magazine. Our priority is to bridge poverty gaps and sustain quality welfare of our clients. Partner with us and watch us help you grow. Pay us a visit today at the NTA headquarters permanent site, Area 11 Garaki, Abuja, or our Lagos office at number 15 Awolowo Road, Ikoyi, Lagos. For more information, visit our website on www.ntaproperties.com.ng, or you can email us on ntapic2000@yahoo.com. Call us on 080-2316-3474 or 080-6939-5185 or 070-3189-0555. NTA Properties Investment Company Limited, the much-needed help at your doorstep.
You're welcome back. If you've just joined us, you're watching Nationwide with me, Joseph Johnson. Reports say the challenges in leadership in the Abia State Assembly has taken another turn. The speaker elected on Thursday, Kennedy Njoku, is said to have resigned this Friday to give way to Chikwendu Kanu. The erstwhile speaker, Martins Azubike, was removed on Thursday in a decision taken by 20 of the 24 members of that legislature. Turning to Kwara State now, because over 135 billion naira has been appropriated for the 2017 fiscal year in Kwara State. Governor Abdul Fattah Ahmed, who presented the proposal before the State House of Assembly, said the budget is to stimulate the socio-economic environment for inclusive growth and development. Abdul Faziz Alaya reports.
Governor Abdel Fattah Ahmed said the appropriation, which was prepared in line with the current financial realities, seeks to sustain and consolidate on the gains of the previous year. the governor explained that with an increase of about 23 billion naira over the 2016 revised appropriation, the 2017 proposal will ensure the completion of all ongoing projects, especially in the areas with direct impact on the welfare of the people. This, he maintained, will be achieved through the reduction in the cost of governance, blocking of leakages, improved internally generated revenue, as well as diversification of production base of the state economy.
I'm aware that this year has been a difficult one for individuals, families, and businesses in Kwara State. I am determined that despite the current challenges and based on proposals I'm presenting today, we will be able to put food on more tables, money in more pockets, and more people in employment this coming year, inshallah.
The proposed budget has about 42% of its total size allocated for recurrent expenditure, 53% for capital expenditure, and 5% for debt service. In Ilorin, Abdullah Hafiz, Alaya, NTA News.
And from Kwara to Ogun State, where the state government has paid 1.6 billion naira severance allowance to four holders that served between 2007 and 2011 and between 2011 and 2015. Ogun State Governor Ibikunle Amotion, at the presentation of checks to beneficiaries, urged political office holders to continue to serve with diligence and dedication to develop the state. Lekong Agbonde completes the story.
Of beneficiaries include commissioners, special advisors, chairmen of boards, and political office holders at the local government level who served during the administration of Chief Gbenga Daniel in 2007 to 2011 and the first term of the current administration. Ogun State Governor Ibikunle Amotion said the state government received 10.6 billion naira from the Paris Club excess debt deduction.
State should endeavor to pay 50%. That was what we agreed. But today, we are not just paying 50%, we have exhausted all the 100%. After exhausting all the 10.6 billion that was given to us, we are now adding more.
The governor also noted that the state government is demanding a review of the monthly allocation sharing formula.
Every account, the money that goes there, Ogun State is second only to Lagos. When they are distributing this money, based on non-oil, they still give Ogun State, we are still in the position of 26, which is not right.
Some of the beneficiaries expressed gratitude to the state government for the gesture.
He said he was going to pay 2007 to 2011. But he could have chosen to pay those who served his first term first. So I'm very, very grateful to him.
One is grateful because the state is progressing. We cannot pray for the state not to progress.
The governor, however, reiterated government's commitment to ensuring welfare of the state workers in Abeokuta, Lekan, Agbon.
Oyo State Governor presents 2017 budget plus. State Police Command parades robbery suspects over to our Ibadan Network Center now with Kemi as our guide. Hello, Kemi.
Hello, Joseph, and welcome to Ibadan. The governor of Oyo State, Abiola Ajimobi, has presented a budget estimate of over 207 billion naira before the state lawmakers for consideration. Correspondent says the budget is a stark budget of self-reliance.
A total budget of 207,671,495,300 naira is being proposed for 2017 fiscal year. The 2017 budget as against 2016 budget of 173.43 billion naira represents 83.5% budget increment. Governor Ajimobi explains that the increment signifies a promising revenue base which will institutionalize prudency. The sectoral allocations of the 2017 budget proposal reflects government's priority on economic, social services, law and justice, and general administration.
We have the ambition of having at the end of 2017, we'll have achieved 90% accessibility to water. has been reinforced by the several ongoing water provision projects at Ibadan, Agete, Igono, Ileru, Ipeti expansion, Ogbomoso expansion, and Igbo-Ora.
While assuring the citizenry of enhanced efforts in improving agriculture and infrastructure, Governor Ajimobi solicits continued support of the people for even development. Speaker of your State House of Assembly, Michael Adeyemo, promises accelerated consideration of the budget proposal.
In the current year, the House, through its oversight functions, has been making its observation notes to the executive in the areas which need further improvement, like education, health, security, and agriculture sector.
The House suggests the need to review rates and taxes collectible in the state, considering the present economic situation. Bank customers, especially users of automated teller machines in Ibadan, are lamenting poor services and hardship to withdraw cash from the machines. Femi Afolabi monitored the situation within the metropolis and filed in this report.
Withdrawing cash from the banking hall and through the automated teller machines in Ibadan has remained Herculean exercise since the Christmas period. Few days to the new year 2017, situation has remained same. Bank customers now spend hours queuing up at the various ATM points due to poor network and inadequate cash in the machine.
The loss of the festivity period, so there are differences. And notwithstanding, it's moving. As you can see, I just withdrew now because people need money here and there. As you rightly said, we were in the bank, then we have to come back here in order to get what we are going to celebrate the season with.
We can't compare this kind of time to the ordinary day. The queue is always long. I went to inside the bank because of the too much queue. That's why I left the place and come to this place.
Unofficial sources in the banks expressed optimism that services will soon improve, advising customers to bear the situation a little more. Although customers say the queue is unbearable compared to the Christmas period, they are hopeful that it will get better in the coming days. From Ibadan, Femi Afolabi, NTA News.
Two suspected notorious armed robbers terrorizing parts of Ibadan have been shot dead by reports.
Two of an eight-man armed robbery gang
Sorry about that gory pictures there, and of course the loss of sound in some parts of that report from our Ibadan Network Center. Still talking about security matters now, the Nasarawa State Command of the Nigeria Police Force has paraded 39 suspects for various offences ranging from armed robbery, kidnapping and rape, among others. Aliyu Tijani Mohammed reports that also in PoliceNet are five suspects in connection with the murder of staff of mining company, including a Chinese national.
While briefing newsmen, State Commissioner of Police in the state, Abubakar Sadiq Bello, says the command was able to record success because of the strategies put in place to counter the activities of criminal elements in the state. He added that such strategies, which include constant raid of black spots, deployment of more patrol teams on highways, as well as community policing within the cities and intelligence-led policing.
The month of December was very challenging because of increase in human activities preparatory to Christmas and New Year celebrations, which is also accompanied with desperate activities of men of the underworld. Here in Nasarawa State, we had our unfair share of it, but I can tell you emphatically that we were able to rise to the occasion.
On the murder of three staff and a Chinese national belonging to Cedar Bay Mining Company in Alogani village of Nasarawa State, five key suspects are in police net, while investigation is still on and they will be charged to court soon, as he warned criminal elements to stay away from the state as there is no hiding place for them. Items recovered include two AK-47 rifles, five locally fabricated guns, live ammunition, vehicles, among others. In Lafia, Aliu Tijani Mohammed, NTA News.
Meanwhile, widows and orphans of officers and men of the Nigeria Police in Abuja smiled home as wife of the Inspector General of Police, Asmal Idris, in the spirit of the season, rolled out welfare packages to cushion their sufferings. Lydia Sampson was there and now reports.
Widowhood is often associated with pain, grief and depression, especially for women who have no education, skills or business to fall back on. Lydia Maxwell became a widow 2 years ago. Her husband served the Nigerian police for 15 years before his demise. With two children to cater for, Lydia Maxwell said life has not been easy. On this occasion, however, Lydia and other widows and their orphan children have risen to sing and dance, courtesy of the wife of the Inspector General of Police, Asmau Idris, who, in the spirit of the season, distributed cash, food items and other materials to cushion their hardship.
The God of the widow is always with you. We are continuing praying because of the Nigeria police. From the Inspector General of Police to the last constable, we, the widow, we are always been praying because of you people.
The gesture not only gladdened the heart of Lydia and other widows, but also a confirmation that the labor of their life in vain.
Our daddy, the Inspector General of Police, and his management team, and our heart desire is that the good Lord will continue to lift you high.
The wife of the Inspector General admonished the widows not to give up but strive to train their children to be law-abiding citizens.
Their husbands have sacrificed all they have for the great nation, Nigeria, here. And of course, the only way we can do is to bring them here to show them that we care and love them. And this is just a token, but it's not the token that matters, it's the message behind it.
The poor president also used the occasion to spread the message of peace, which he says the country needs to drive the change agenda of the government. In Abuja, Lydia Sampson, NTA News.
Also, the Voice of Restoration Assembly Church has held a dinner to celebrate children of the Fakado Orphanage, New Karu, in Nasarawa State on the occasion of the Yuletide season. The event, which is part of the church's activities to mark the end of the year and give back to society, witnessed the presentation of cash and food items to the less privileged. The senior pastor of the church, Jesse Ekong, used the occasion to advise Nigerians on the way out of the economic recession.
The orphanage, and there will be a blessing to them, because this Christmas cannot be complete without somebody laughing, smiling, eating food. And if you look at the less privileged, they have nothing. So we gather them every year as a church. God gave me that vision to make sure that we put smiles on their faces. And also my message to Nigerians is that we should put our trust in God and also be patient with Mr. President and the government.
The Nigerian Christian Pilgrims Commission says it will approach the National Assembly for a law to provide stringent penalties for those who have gone during the exercise. Executive Secretary of the Commission, Tor Uja, said this while reviewing the exercise. Makut Simon Macham reports from Jerusalem.
Thousands of Nigerian Christians perform the pilgrimage to Israel, Rome and Greece annually. This year, many made the trip to Israel, where they visited spiritual sites across the country and prayed for themselves and Nigeria. Speaking on the 2016 exercise, the Executive Secretary of the Nigerian Christian Pilgrims Commission, Tor Uja, said though the exercise went pretty well, reports of some abscondments which have been appraised are worrisome.
We find it very successful. Each of the times we had pilgrims all over, and we think it's nice. We also exposed a good percentage of our pilgrims to Israeli agricultural expertise.
He said henceforth, tough measures will be taken.
Both NCPC and the government of Nigeria is highly against abscondment. We will never support abscondment.
Meanwhile, some of the pilgrims and tour operators have also been given their verdict on the exercise.
So we talk to them in their language and we make sure that they feel we are part of them.
We are not coming here for play. We are not coming here to
look the you come here to contact the covenant.
So praying for Nigeria from the Holy Land here, we strongly believe that the God who has kept us together as one nation since independence, that same God will keep us as one nation, will not be divided.
As Nigerian pilgrims return from the pilgrimage to the Holy Land of Israel, it is expected that whatever they have done here will reflect in their lifestyle. Nigerians also expect that the prayers they have offered for the nation will come to pass. From Jerusalem in Israel, Makut Simon Macham, NTA News.
Let's get to some of the other news from around the world. Russian President Vladimir Putin says he will not threat the path of the US with their diplomats as Greece is set to introduce electronic ID cards for refugees and migrants. These and much more on Global Tidbits with Ogechi Paul.
Russian President Vladimir Putin says he will not retaliate by expelling US diplomats from Russia after the US expelled 35 Russian diplomats amid a row over hacking. Putin says Russia will, however, work to restore ties with the U.S. President-elect Donald Trump. Russia has continued to deny any involvement in hacking regarding the U.S. elections. Angolan President José Eduardo dos Santos' daughter, reportedly Africa's richest woman, has been cleared to head the national oil company Sonangol after a court rejected a legal challenge. Isabel dos Santos was put in charge of Sonangol in June in a move some analysts say was the first sign of succession plans for the country's long-time ruler. His daughter's appointment was disputed by lawyers who say the law did not allow public officials to nominate family members, but the Supreme Court ruled in her favor. And finally, Migration Minister of Greece says the country is set to give electronic ID cards to thousands of refugees and migrants trapped on its soil. The minister said the ministry intends to register all refugees and migrants in Greece living in camps, hotels and flats to enable government know their legal status and places of abode. He further states that the government plans to give out cash handouts of up to €400 monthly to enable migrant families fend for themselves. Greece says it has more than 600 refugees and migrants in the soil, mainly Syrians. That's Global Tidbit, Ogechi Paul, NTA News.
And in sports, developing football at the grassroots as the needed impetus for improved performances by Nigerian players and teams was the thrust of discussion when the Director General Voice of Nigeria, Osita Okechukwu, received the FCT Football Association Friday. Ayodeji Makinde tells us more.
The inability of football club sides in the Federal Capital Territory to gain promotion and challenge for honours in the Nigeria Professional Football League remains a major concern for enthusiasts, administrators and footballers in Abuja. In a bid to halt this trend, a delegation of the FCT Football Association has solicited the support of the Voice of Nigeria towards the grassroots development of the sport in the six area councils. The Director General, Voice of Nigeria, Osita Okechukwu, while receiving the delegation led by Godwin Bamigboye in Abuja Friday, says efforts are underway to revive the organization's football team in the wake of increased contribution of the sport to global economy.
The same revival we did for the organs and more training for the staff, I promise you people that we're going to revive our team.
We have been talking to clubs, improve your recruitment of players. Recruit players properly. Get the best materials.
The VON DG also received the staff of the organization, Gidado Usman, who recently completed his Confederation of African Football A coaching license while pledging to support the FCT Football Association. In Abuja, Ayodeji Makinde, NTA News.
And Nigerians in the diaspora support the development of baseball in the country as the English Premier League enters week 19 weekend. Kene Emabudike is our guide on sports update.
Nigeria's bid to make debut appearance in the baseball event of the 2020 Tokyo Olympics received a boost Thursday when Japanese star of Nigeria origin Louis Okoye, led by Japanese Embassy's Charge d'Affaires Otsuka Masaya, paid a courtesy visit to the Federal Ministry of Youth and Sports Development in Abuja Sports Minister Solomon Dalu, represented by the Permanent Secretary Chinyaka Oha, says the visit will spur preparation for the Games and strengthen diplomatic ties between the two countries.
We therefore consider the good attention your country, Japan, is paying to baseball and the encouragement being given to the rising Nigerian-Japanese baseball athlete in the person of Mr. Louis Okoye as a welcome development.
The 19-year-old outfielder who plays for Tohoku Rakuten Golden Eagles also watched a selected team play an inning at the Abuja National Stadium baseball oval. Meanwhile, first stanza fixtures